Okay, so today we have a central lecture where we are presenting the radiation field. We derived it last time and see how the radiation field actually interacts with a molecule, with the electrons in a molecule. And I gave you, I posted this morning problem set 2 that deals with this matter, and I bring it up here so that you have a warning. There should be the problems that should be here. Where are they? You were supposed to hand it in today, right? Mm-hmm. So you just hand it in here and then we pick it up.
A lot of people emailed it, I think.
No, we don't email it. So,
there's a file on BioCore that says you can email it to the TAs.
You can. Because they're pictures. But if there was any wording necessary, what do you do?
So I type it up in LaTeX, so it doesn't matter.
Okay, LaTeX, my God, very fancy. Okay, good, then it's fine, but I think we don't have this again. You have to produce some color images, so from now on, we always collect it here. But it's right, it's stated that you should send it then. Okay, great. The problem set today is looks lengthy, but it is in fact only long because it is sort of Mickey Mouse. It's a second problem set, so I wanted to still make it easy. So I give you every step and say, show this, show this, show that. And so you can really work through it very quickly. But you know, it takes a little time, so you might not want to wait. Particularly since it offers the first case study on water and ice, and I think the second time you have a case study, it will be already faster. But the first time, it might, you know, be a little lengthy. You really need to know VMD now to utilize it to answer the questions for the case study. So it might be better that you start with the homework test rather earlier than later. Okay, so let's then talk about how the radiation field interacts with the molecule. And we have here our radiation field. And the radiation field was characterized by us through a vector potential A. That is a position, a function of position and time. And A obeyed the equation Laplace operator acting on all three components of A minus dt squared A is zero, since we assume that there are no currents in the field. In the radiation field away from where the field is actually generated in case of solar radiation in the sun. And your first homework problem is actually to solve this equation. I do it for you now very quickly, and then you have to do it sort of step by step yourself. And so the solution of this equation, this is what you're supposed to demonstrate, is that A is equal to a constant times a vector. Since we pull a constant out, it's reasonable to make this a unit vector so that all the magnitude is in the coefficient A0. And then we use a complex representation, but whenever we calculate something physical observable, then we only take the real part. So so this is our quantity, and we have then some relationships here between k and omega that comes already from this equation, and that says that k squared is equal omega squared. So k and omega are related to each other. K is magnitude-wise 2 pi over lambda, and omega is the frequency 1 over time. And we also have the, so this is just a definition, the wavelength tells you when you go along the direction of R, when you are getting this exactly the same magnitude again, and that's of course when you add to R in a certain direction, lambda times the direction, you're getting exactly the same value, and that you call then the wavelengths, and that is how K is then defined. And then we have another property, I put it here because I want to use that space there, and that is that we have K dot U, U is this unit vector here, is zero, they're perpendicular to each other, and that comes from our condition that divergence A was zero, from that we are getting this condition. So then now we wanted to interpret these quantities, and I said that that is being done through the Poynting vector that gives us a flow of energy in the system, and that Poynting vector is usually called S is equal to 1 over 4 pi times the real part of E connected with the radiation. We said we had we have two field components. One is electrical field from the radiation. We call that ET, cross product with the real part of B, where we had B was rotation of A, and ET was minus the tiny time derivative of A. Okay, so if we do this, then we find that S is equal to, now I have to look at my cheat sheet here. That was correct. That was correct, yes, right. And I'm getting now here plus minus sign from these two choices here. It can be omega, can be there minus or plus. And if we have minus or plus, and we're getting here for the quantity S that is a physical observable plus minus. So the signs have a real meaning. And then we're getting omega squared. Oh, sorry, not omega squared, sorry. Omega times A0 squared divided by 8 pi. Check that. Really true, that's right, that's right. Sorry, divided by 4 pi. Sorry, 4 pi. 4 pi times sine squared of k dot r minus omega minus plus omega t. Let me check that that's really exactly the way it is. Yes, that's how it is. Times times k. And I call this one actually the unit vector k. I make it the unit vector, and I know that the magnitude of k is omega, and then I have here omega squared. Okay, and now that means that the energy flows in the direction of k. So if I now plot this the situation, then I have here k, and we calculated last time the quantities b and e, and what we find there is that e, so if we use these formulas, and we find that e is so it's a time derivative, and so it is just I omega times a zero u times sine of this jazz here that we have here too. And b is equal to I k cross I a zero times u times sine. So if you now look that k is perpendicular to u, and e is along u. So if we have radiation where this one is u, then e goes in this direction, and b goes perpendicular to it. Now b is also orthogonal to k, because it's a cross product of k times another vector, and that is the cross product always perpendicular to then the two vectors. So k goes in this direction, we have then perpendicular direction here, perpendicular direction here, perpendicular direction here. And so you call now the direction of the electrical field component of the radiation the polarization of the radiation. And okay, so we have now polarization, that's also the direction which E points, and then we have the magnetic field perpendicular to it, and the third perpendicular component is the direction K, and this is where the radiation propagates, because this is the direction in which the radiation carries its energy. So if we then would look at the electrical field dependence at one moment in time along a certain direction, then it has this sine behavior, and the cosine goes just perpendicular to it. And so this is how they go. Now if we are looking now at S, then we find that it's sine squared of a time-dependent function, and the omega, you do that also in your homework set, that's problem one. Omega is very, 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 very high number, 10 to the 15 per second, and so this variation is not really playing a role anywhere. You can average over it. There's no motion that has that frequency in a biological system. And so we can just replace this one by its average. And that average is, of course, 1/2. And so then we have the energy flow averaged over time equal to omega squared times a zero squared divided by 8 pi times the direction of k, okay, so this is what it is, that is the energy flow. And now in our present units, C is equal 1. Usually when you write down the Maxwell equations in a pedestrian way where you keep every the velocity of light and you're getting here 1 over C squared, but we don't have it here because we just, in our units, it's explained in the notes, we just put it equal to 1. And now we remember 1 is actually the velocity of light, then we know that this here gives us actually, this is the energy flow, gives us a velocity of energy. So the velocity is 1, and that means this one had also the magnitude 1. That means this one here is actually an energy flow without directionality. And so we can equate this one here then to square root of n. How many number photons do we have in the system per volume? And each photon has an energy h bar omega. And so this is the density, our energy density, number of photons times h bar omega divided by the volume. That is our thing, times velocity, which is actually a vector, so I put here velocity, but velocity is 1. Our velocity of light is 1. And so now we can determine what A0 is. A0 is equal to, now we bring this over and we are getting then square root of a pi times the number of photons with the frequency omega divided by omega times the volume over which we measure the photon density. And so this is our magnitude. So we know the magnitude there. And now we know everything. So we have characterized through the polarization, through the propagation direction, the radiation. Now we have the third quantity that we need to give, namely the magnitude. And then, of course, we need to know either k or omega. They're related to each other. So we need to know either the frequency or the wavelengths. And so now we can characterize our radiation through A is equal to square root of 8 pi times n omega divided by omega the volume times u times e to the I k dot r minus omega t, where k is a three-dimensional vector, can be in any direction, but u is perpendicular to k, and so u is actually only a two-dimensional vector because it can only be end of unit 1 because it cannot be parallel to the propagation direction. So these are all our degrees of freedom for the radiation, and we know that our amplitude is related to how many photons do we have per volume. And so then we know what the radiation field is. So that we bagged. So now we have here on this side the molecule. So we are with our molecule, biomolecule. And the biomolecule is described in terms of what we need to know when we have optical radiation field, like visible light interact with a molecule. It's not clear, so clear to you, but the optical light only interacts actually with the electrons of the molecule, not with the nuclei of the molecule. The nuclei vibrate, and if you put something in the microwave, you heat it up, those are vibrations. So if we would talk about a microwave field, we would not talk about the nuclei and describe them. But no, we are not going to talk about the microwave oven. We are talking about solar radiation. and they interact with electrons. And so when we are now looking at the molecule, we are really only interested in the electrons of the molecule because they are the ones that interact with the radiation. We can very easily go also to microwave radiation and have then see how that interacts, but that's much less interesting. And you know, if you want to go into food processing, maybe that's really hot for you. But if you are interested in vision photosynthesis and other processes where the solar radiation interacts with life, you have to focus on the electrons. So how the electrons described? The electrons are described through Hamiltonian. They are quantum mechanical particles that have a momentum squared divided by the mass of the electron, 2 mE. That's the kinetic energy of the electron. This is just one electron. If we have several electrons, we just sum over all the electrons that are there. But I just want to talk at the moment just about one to keep things in principle and simple. Okay, this is one electron, but the electron, of course, in a molecule sees an electrostatic field from the nuclei and from the other electrons. And so we have to add here a field plus Q times V, where V is the electrostatic field due to the nuclei and the other electrons. So that is it, and we put here a hat on top of the P, because now we are talking quantum physics, and in quantum physics, this Hamiltonian is actually not just an energy number, but rather an energy operator, and so the P is actually an operator, namely the gradient operator multiplied 4 by h bar over I. So that is what that P stands for. And this is our biomolecule. But now we have an interaction here. This interacts. So here we have another operator that should describe how our molecule interacts with the radiation field. There has to be something that combines it. Now it turns out that you can do this very simply by just changing the Hamiltonian in the following way. So the radiation field is described through a vector potential, and now quantum physics, actually classical physics, tells you that, and it's just in a translation from classical physics to quantum physics, is that you know when you have also the presence of a vector potential, you can immediately write down now the Hamiltonian that is affecting a particle that is subject to an electrostatic potential and a vector potential. And the way it works is that you just take your P and you subtract from it the vector potential multiplied by the charge and square it. So basically you alter the momentum by minus QA and the rest stays the same. Now since Q is in our case minus E, where E is the electron charge, the absolute value of the electron charge, we can write this one as P plus E A squared divided by 2ME minus E times V. This is our Hamiltonian in the presence of the radiation field. So you either now believe it, or if you say, oh, what is the professor doing? Look in your quantum physics book. And look quantum physics and look at vector potential, and there you see that's how a vector potential alters a normal Hamiltonian that doesn't have a vector potential yet. You just added to the momentum. Okay, so that's what we do. And now we would like to know the perturbation. That means we would like to know how this differs from this. Can we write this Hamilton, this new Hamiltonian, as the old Hamiltonian? Maybe I call this one zero. This is the old one, and this is the new one with the interaction. Can we write this one as the old Hamiltonian plus a perturbation? Yes, we can. So let's do that. So we can write then H as, now we just start to work on it. And we do that. But before I do that, I just would like to know, what are we going to do with the Hamiltonian? So what we want to do is we want to find out how the radiation field alters the molecule. If we just would go through without altering it, we don't want to calculate it. But it actually does something. It leads to what are called electronic excitations of the molecule. That means the electrons change their quantum state. And so, with other words, when the radiation field comes, the electrons change over time their wave function, their quantum mechanical state. And so we need to solve to study the effect of the radiation. We need to solve the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, not the time-independent one, because the radiation field is a time-dependent field, and we expect that something changes over time. So we solve the time-dependent Schrödinger equation. And that equation is IH bar dt psi, this one is a wave function of the electron. So we can just at the moment assume it's just one single electron. And how we go to many electrons is another story. And for our purposes, it's completely sufficient. And you will see that we just look at how the radiation actually affects an individual electron in the molecule, and that is an equal to H times psi. So we need to know how this operator H affects the wave function of the electron, and so this is what we need to calculate. And so this is what we do. We now take then H and actons on the wave function psi. And this is how our H looks like, P plus EA squared divided by 2ME, exon psi minus EV exon psi. This is very trivial, because the V is an operator that is actually just multiplying the wave function by the potential. So that's sometimes we don't even call it an operator. So it's really very trivial. We don't have to worry there at all. But here we have to worry. So here's something happening. Okay, so what we do it here one by one. And we go now here. And now we begin to expand this one. And so expanding it means that we have now P plus E. Sorry that I do it very pedestrian. For a reason, sorry, and P plus EA divided by 2ME times psi plus, so I don't write the V anymore, too trivial. So I don't write the EV psi. Okay, and so now if I do this, then I'm getting one time P exon P and on psi. P is a gradient operator. But here we have a scalar product because we have the square of this thing. So we have then the gradient operator acts on the scalar on the on the on, on, and get a product. So what we are getting then actually is we're getting P squared divided by 2ME acting on psi with our first term P and psi, so we're getting this one. We are getting then minus EV psi from this term, and this is just our old Hamiltonian. So very good, everything is great, plus the rest, the perturbation. And now we write the perturbation. And the perturbation is, one time we have P acting on A, acting on psi. So this is P, maybe I write E in front, E over 2ME. Then we have P acting on A, acting on psi. A is just a multiplicative operator, just a vector potential multiplies the wave function psi, which is a scalar, by a vector valued function. It has an x component, a y component, and a z component. So this one is just one number, but this one are three numbers. The x component of it times psi, the y component times psi, and the z component. Okay. And so we have this one. Then the second term is, so this one was this, this, this. Then the next one is, again, E over 2ME. And then we have A acts on P, acts on psi. This one we have. And then we have a last one, where E, A acts on A, acts on psi. So there we're getting E squared divided by 2ME times A squared times psi. So those terms we have. Now this term here, we want to look at a little bit more carefully. And so we are writing as E over 2ME. And now we know this one is H bar over I times the gradient operator of a vector function multiplying psi. Divergence operator, because this one is a scalar product of P with the rest, so this is a divergence. This one is then a divergence operator acting on this. So this is just this one. And if we look, what is the divergence of this kind of function? You can look it up in your favorite book of formulas, and you find that this one is, you just do it and you find you're getting two contributions. You're getting one contribution that reads like A dot gradient psi. That's the first contribution. And the second contribution is psi divergence A. Well, now I need your help. Anybody can help me?
Didn't we pick A to be divergenceless a little while ago?
That's right. Yeah, divergenceless, no. Everything has a divergence. Use English properly. Divergenceless is misnomer.
Pick A to have a divergence of zero.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So this term does not contribute. And so we're getting then E over 2ME times H bar over I times here. So we're getting A P psi, which is exactly this term. So we're getting this term twice. And so we can write then this one as E over ME, because we're getting it twice, times the vector potential multiplying P acting on psi. And then we are getting plus E squared over 2ME A squared acting on psi. So now you look for typical values of A in the solar radiation field. You know, we have here photons of light of wavelengths between 400 and 800 nanometer, and we have a certain volume. We can measure the density. Then we're getting an A0. We know what A is in the solar. We go outside the green street. We know what it is, and we find that this quantity here that multiplies the wave function, the absolute value of it, is about 10 to the minus 7 eV. Whereas this one here, after you take the gradient of the wave function is a typical electronic wave function, so it has certain kind of gradients, not a huge gradient, not a small gradient, typical gradient that you find in the molecule, you find this one is 10 to the minus 3 eV. So it is 4 orders of magnitude larger. So with other words, you don't need to consider the second term and take only the first one because it's much larger, except there are some cases where this one, for symmetry reason, for example, does not contribute, and then is this one is the largest term. It can happen, yes. And in fact, it happened even in biology. There are some cases where this term is very important. For example, you can explain with this perturbation why the sky is blue. And that is this term. This one doesn't contribute to the scattering of the sky. This one is a leading contribution. And the sky is beautiful blue. If you go to Italy or Greece, it's even bluer than here. Just gorgeous. Red in the evening. Why that? This guy is doing it. But under most circumstances, the first one contributes. It's much bigger than the second one. And so we can ignore it, and for the time being, we will ignore it. Okay, so this is now it. And so now we can write this one. We can put it away and replace it by a real quantity, maybe by E over ME times the vector potential that we determined with the scalar product of the momentum operator acting on the wave function of the electron. And this is our perturbation. So we have it. Okay. Good. So here we can breathe a little, and maybe I invite questions, and then I continue on. So any question? So basically this material is all written up in the notes, and the only thing that you really need is, not even that, you can even, if some of you want to sleep now, take a rest. I invite you 15 minutes about, and then I tell you, oh, please wake up again. You have to listen now so that you know what these quantities mean, that if we have a K, if we have an omega, if we have a U, that you know where this stuff comes from. But otherwise, the formulas that we really need to describe how radiation is absorbed by a molecule or how it is emitted by an excited molecule, those are coming in a second, not in a second, about 10, 15 minutes. And those you need to know. This is all the theory that it is described. You can go through it. We write the key formula down for you in the notes we give you. But in that complete lecture notes on quantum physics, chapter 8, you find the total derivation, all the detail there. Okay, good. So then let's apply it. Now it turns out that that the key part of the radiation field that influences a molecule is actually the time dependence. It is this, made a mistake, shame on me. This minus plus omega t. And so we are writing now that is one thing that I have to tell you. I have to tell you one other thing. So that's one thing. That time dependent will play really the key role. The second thing I have to tell you is a little bit more abstract, but very important, and that is that here we just have one kind of radiation with a certain k value that can be anything from a universe of k values, with a certain polarization that can be anything in a plane, and with a certain frequency that can be anything from zero to infinity. Even from minus infinity to plus infinity, it depends on if the radiation is incoming or outgoing. So there are lots of choices. This is one choice. Where are all the other choices? Now, the way we can do this is that we have here really one mode. The real field is A is sum over all possible k values. K is of course also equal to frequency omega. Maybe I write here plus minus for incoming and outgoing. And then we have square root of 8 pi n omega divided by omega v times e to the I k r minus plus, I put here minus omega t, but it can also be the choice plus. Maybe I put here minus plus, and so we have both choices are being summed over. So we sum over all these contributions, they all are there. If we are not doing an experiment, if we just take solar radiation that is basically determined by whatever is coming from the sun, then this is A0. If you have a laser, then you might have it very, very different. You might have a very high photon density. Don't look into the laser. You hurt your eyes. You might have a very I left out a very important factor, the polarization, of course. So you might have a certain polarization. You might have put a linear polarizing filter there, or you have a circular polarizing filter in front of your laser, behind your laser, for what is coming out there, and so on. You can prepare it, shape it, or you just get it whatever comes from the sun, like what biological life forms have to do. So this is a radiation field. And now I tell you that you don't have to worry about all these sums that really look awful. If you're a physicist, you have to worry about it. And that is actually something connected with what you call quantum electrodynamics, where Schwinger and what is this other guy from Caltech? Feynman got the Nobel Prize for it, to formulate it properly, but we don't have to worry about all the terms coming there, because we will see that yes, they are all there. Like in this room, you have all these ones with very, very high frequency X-ray radiation, hopefully not too much here, hopefully that they don't have an X-ray source here that they don't tell us about, so that we have here some X-ray modes and we are all getting cancer from it. But it could be, yes, so whatever is here, we have it here present, even though we don't realize it. Why don't we realize it? Why don't we? Because the molecules, P, pick out the radiation that they can energetically accept. That they can accept also through their direction, in which direction it polarized, and which direction the molecules point. They like certain polarized light and not others. But mainly they select it through the energy H bar omega. And so everything that our molecules cannot absorb energy-wise, we just don't see. They're going all the way here, we don't pick them, we don't see them. So with other words, we are picking out only the modes that are fitting our molecules energy-wise, and the other ones, we can ignore them. So we write them all and we pick just out the ones that are just matching energy-wise. And we will see the formulas reflect that exactly. Okay, so now we have that one solved, and now we have to write our perturbation. So I write this perturbation in the following form. So this comes now, here comes now the perturbation. And the perturbation is now V, an operator, that is a function of R and of T, particularly of T, that's what we are really interested in. Actually, it's not a function of R, because this one is a gradient operator in R, so it's an operator in R, but let me just write it through R like this. Okay, and so now what we are getting is, we can write it as, if we're looking at here, x on psi, the perturbation, but x on psi, and what we are getting is a term that looks like V, Okay, so this is our thing, and we write as follows. We write E over ME times A times square root of 8 pi N omega 1, or maybe I call it N1, divided by omega 1 V times U1 times E to the I K1 dot R minus omega 1 T, that is one mode of the many modes there that I represent. And then I might have a second mode plus E over ME square root of 8 pi N2 over omega 2 V U2 E to the I K2 dot R minus plus omega 2 T. So what I did is here, I can say plus more, but I just want to write 2 so that we see what happens if we have 2. Do they interfere with each other? Do they fight each other? Or are they just additive with each other? So we get one mode and the other mode. And for the second mode, I will put in, it can be minus or plus. Let's put it in for good measure, because we have the two choices. So that is what our perturbation is. And we write this perturbation, so this one I will ignore, plus dot dot dot. I write this perturbation now as V operator 1 times e to the minus I omega 1 t plus V operator 2 times e to the minus plus I omega 2 t. Telling you that the one that really matters is really the time dependence is so important, we pull it out extra. And the V1, it's an operator, of course, that is also important, but we sum it all into one particular quantity. And so it's clear what V1 is. V1 is in this case, sorry that I do a little mathematical funny thing here by putting the thing here. This one is V1. And here we have V2. So this is my perturbation. Okay, good. So at this point we take some picture of the board and then we continue with. So you can ask questions. So what I do now is I now take a jump. So the nodes then derive what is called time-dependent perturbation theory. And they say what kind of effect does this kind of perturbation have on a quantum system, and so that is in the notes, and then they tell you there are transitions between the state of the quantum system, between the stationary state of the quantum system, and those transitions have a certain rate by which you go from one state to another state, and that formula I tell you. And the derivation is in the notes. So you have this radiation, it acts, and with time, our system goes from one state, so-called stationary state of the quantum system, to another stationary state of the quantum system. And the formulas describe how they do that.
Yes. So I'm not sure I completely understand where you're going with the V1 and the V2 that you've just boxed there.
Yeah, they come now into this formula, that they appear now exactly in both rates.
Okay, so they just represent different frequencies of light incoming.
They represent this stuff. They represent this number, times a unit vector, times a function e to the ik 1 dot r. Ah, I forgot the most important thing. I forgot this one. So, of course, we have this momentum operator there. Okay. So we have to take picture again.
So is the perturbation small compared to the?
That's a good question to ask. So the energy differences in a molecule is they go from the highest energy differences for the molecules that are for the electrons that are most strongly bound by the molecule, they are 10-20 eV. If you have light atoms, if you have heavy atoms, they can be much higher. But in biomolecules, you usually have carbon, oxygen, nitrogen, sometimes you have a phosphorus atom or a calcium atom, and those are then higher energies. And then the electrons that are the lightest bound, those are absorbing optical radiation, and they absorb usually in around 1 eV, like usually 1.5 to 3 eV, which is optical radiation. To observe there, you have to make the molecules pretty long. If you make the molecule too small, then most weakly bound electrons absorb, let's say, at around 5 eV, which is UV radiation, but not optical radiation. And so, the electrons that we are after absorb around 1 eV, loosely speaking, and this one is a thousandth of it. So it's really a perturbation. Okay, so. So now we have to go and describe the molecule as we have it there, and we begin by just doing a very simple job, and then we improve on that job. And so quantum states of the molecule. So the molecule is just described in this fashion. And what you find is that you have in this Hamiltonian H0, and then you have states n, and they have an energy En, and you obey this stationary Schrödinger equation. And you're getting this kind of states where n, let's say, goes from 0, 1, 2, you have a certain number of states for the electrons. But we don't want to say more than we have for electrons, a real quantum particles, we have discrete states, or else we have states with discrete energies. Just like a really good example is actually just a hydrogen atom, where you have the 1s state, the 2s state, the 2p states, and so on. And so in a moment, we will describe those a little bit more carefully. But at this moment, we just assume that the electrons are being described by the states. And what we like to know is the rate of absorption, for example, we also do that then for emission, from 0, from the lower state, let's say we usually you number them by going with the energy up, the higher the n, the higher the energy, we want to absorb from 0 to n. What is this rate? So we call this rate k 0 n. And what is the rate? And it turned out the rate is 2 pi over h bar times, if we have this situation, times V1 squared, times 0 V1 n absolute value squared. This is the matrix element where V1 acts first on the wave function. Acts on this wave function, but you can also put 0 here and here, it's the same value. And then you take the scalar product with the other wave function. And so we have this one times delta of epsilon, En minus E0 minus h bar omega. So this is a rate with which we absorb this mode of the perturbation, where the V1 is this operator. So when we want to calculate it, we have to put all the detail in. And you do that for the hydrogen atom at the homework set. And so this is our first contribution. And then we have the second contribution there, and it turns out that in lowest order perturbation theory, which is really giving us the leading order, and it's a very, very good description, we are getting from the second contribution just another term from the second one, except that we have now V2, and here we have a delta function where we have now here d and 0 minus plus h bar omega. So if we are now looking at when is the delta function contributing, then here it contributes if en is equal to e0 plus h bar omega. So we have then a situation that if this one is e0 and this one is en, it lies above En by the energy h bar omega 1. Sorry, this one was omega 1 here. Sorry, here omega 1. This was our first one. This is omega 2. So here we have then an energy diagram that looks either like the same, except this one is now h bar omega 2, and this one is E0, and this one is En. Or we have an energy diagram where E0 is on the top, and En is further down, and we are actually losing the energy. The energy comes out. So you see that this plus minus situation that we thought it's a pointing vector of having forward moving energy flow or backward moving energy flow enters in our formula that calculates how the radiation is actually altering the quantum state through an energy conservation principle. If we have minus omega, we add energy. If we have plus omega, we subtract energy from the molecule during the process. So this is and so this is it. And now you see, if you have more modes, you add them. And now you see that energy conservation means that the only modes that you can actually take care of by the system are those where the energies match. The other ones, they don't matter. They are zero for all practical purposes. Forget them. So this is how the system very naturally picks out the modes by energy. But now we would like to know, of course, the magnitude of the rate. Here we have just now the quality of the rate determined by energy conservation. And now we need to also understand the magnitude, and there we need to calculate the amplitude. And so now we want to see how that works. So we just look at one of those quantities. And if we are looking at it, then we find that we have to look at the matrix element 0, V1, n, and this one is equal to E over ME, square root of 8 pi n omega divided by omega V, and then we have 0, and then we have we have u from here, and then we have 0 p p e to the I k dot r minus omega t times acting on this matrix element. And you do this matrix element for the hydrogen atom, where this one is the 2p state and this one is the 1s state. And the way you do this is you have to integrate. Now this is now an integral, a volume integral, and you use best radial coordinates in case of the hydrogen atom going from 0 to infinity, dr, r squared. Then you integrate over the theta angle, cosine theta, from minus 1 to plus 1. So the variable is cosine theta rather than the angle theta. Otherwise, you go from 0 to pi. And then you integrate over the azimuthal angle from 0 to 2 pi. And now you have now a wave function here. That is a wave function phi 0 of r and of theta and of phi. And then you have here h bar over I gradient e to the I k dot r. And then acting on the wave function phi n of r and theta and phi. And so in the homework set, I give you this one for the 2p state of the hydrogen atom. I give you this one for the 1s state of the hydrogen atom. But now it turns out this is actually not easy to calculate because of this factor. You have to take the gradient, which is, and then you have this one. Now it turns out that these wave functions vary. So now I mean where they really change their value. Over one angstrom, roughly. Five angstrom or something, but about one angstrom. This one, like same here, you know, this one. And this one also changes over one angstrom. You know, hydrogen atom, you know how the orbitals decay exponentially, decay if either a zero, the Bohr radius, or one half or two b zero, but it's about an angstrom. Whereas k, this one, we can write it as one plus k dot r. K dot r plus, you know, one half squared and so on. If you look at how this one varies, then here we have 1 plus 2 pi over lambda times the unit vector of k dot r. And now you see that we are getting here only a contribution, a deviation from 1 when r changes considerably relative to to lambda. But lambda is 4,000 to 8,000 angstrom. So three orders of magnitude larger than the variation there. So over the scale of the hydrogen atom, this is not changing. And so as a result, we can ignore it. And we can ignore this one. And now it turns out that gets rid of two headaches. One headache is we don't need to put this one in, just one. And second is we don't even have to calculate the gradient. That's a beautiful trick that is explained in the notes. And you can show that this one can be written as, this integral can be written as, now I write it in this form because it's more succinct, I don't have to write all of integrals there, can be written as E times ME divided by I, complex I, or imaginary number I, times zero R N. So I can replace a gradient by just the radius. Or rather, this is how it usually referred to, you put the E there, then you call it the dipole moment. You can replace it by the, no, I don't use the word dipole moment. I don't use the word dipole moment. Sorry that I'm Mickey Mouse now. I don't use the word dipole moment. It is a transition dipole moment. If it's a dipole moment, it would be nn or 0, 0. That would be then a dipole moment. But 0, n is a transition dipole moment. It has the same unit as a dipole moment. Also, it's typically, you know, from the value, it looks like a dipole moment. It's about the same value as a dipole moment. But it measures the ability of the molecule to make the transition. So this is a transition dipole moment. E M E over I times transition dipole moment. So this is the most important word that you learned today, because this is a quantity that describes the ability of a molecule to absorb radiation. This omega tells you how much energy the radiation has. That goes into energy conservation. That's, of course, also very, very important. But then the actual magnitude is given by this one. So if we put it all together in our formula here, then we can write already k as 2 pi over h bar times e over me times, here we are getting now e times me times, squared. E was right, but sorry, this E, no, this E was wrong. This E is wrong here. This one is an H bar. I apologize. Sorry. That is an H bar. The professor makes mistakes all the time. So it is, let me see. Yeah, no. Also wrong. That is really my bad hour. Omega. So it measures the energy difference between the two. Sorry, from the derivation, I should have known. So omega me over I. That is what is there. So omega me over I. So that goes there. So then we are getting here omega me squared. So then we have that. Then we have 8 pi n omega over omega v times, and now we have, actually, times, and now we have, what do we have left? We have then now left u times n r, sorry, 0, n absolute value squared times delta e n minus e 0 minus h bar omega just for the first term. But this is a code, this is a rate. Except for something that is explained in the notes. I don't want to do that now because I want to get just one step further. Though I don't go into too much detail. I told you that when we're working with a complex electrical field, magnetic field, and vector potential. But when we calculate quantities, we have to do real. And so I have to now replace in this formula this one by the real part. And the way that works very simply is I take this one times 1/2, and then I take this one plus conjugate complex. 1/2 plus 1/2 conjugate complex. Now the conjugate complex 1/2 has e to the plus I omega t. But at the moment I'm interested in a mode that is being absorbed. I told you that other mode with the other direction of the sign is being emitted, but at the moment my energy conversion is interested in saying I start from the ground set. I cannot fluoresce anything from the ground, so I can only go up. So this one is irrelevant. But the 1/2 is not irrelevant. So if I do 1/2 squared, so here I have to add a 1/2 from the real partners. And that means I have to add here 1/4 from the real partners. And so then I have altogether 4 pi squared times e squared times omega squared times n omega over omega, so I'm getting only an omega here, sorry, over omega, divided by v, h bar v, and times u dot 0 r n squared times delta, the energy conversion. And that's my formula. Fortunately, I don't make quite the next one. So the problem set will be altered a little bit. The problem 3, I will have to take off because you cannot do it yet. So don't start the problem set and do it today. Later today, I will just take that problem out and put it in the next problem set. Okay. So this is what we have for the absorption. So we're getting here magnitude. We're getting here. Sort of like these are just physical constants, epsilon, of course, the energy is there, energy is of course also here, but otherwise trivial stuff. The real interesting stuff is here, the transition dipole moment with the scalar product of the polarization of the radiation, that squared is what tells you how a molecule can absorb radiation. So this is a molecular property that is used by evolution, but also by any engineer, by any chemist, to design a molecule that absorbs a certain type of radiation. So energy comes here. Here comes the polarization of the radiation, and this is a molecular property. So let me then tell you that in the problem 2, where you do the calculation for the hydrogen atom, you are now calculating actually if you have a radiation field that comes from any direction, how that is being, how this form is then modified. So you don't only have one radiation field, but now you have all possible polarizations. Because here the radiation in this room is unpolarized. So it's a lot of statistics going on. And now if I absorb something with my skin, it's not polarized light that comes here, but it comes with all the polarization. So you average over all directions. That's done in the notes. And then we have a simpler formula, naturally, that tells you how that kind of radiation is being absorbed. And that formula is what you apply. And so you have to maybe do a little bit of reading ahead already on your own. I explain it the next time. It takes me 10 minutes or so. But you have to be a little careful. So you don't use exactly this formula, but sort of the next formula where you have radiation that is absorbed or emitted that can have any kind of polarization. Okay. So I think you learned a lot today. Because, you know, this is physics that was really hot physics in the 30s and 40s, but it's very, very relevant in biological physics. It is how molecules actually interact with the radiation field, and you learn that they observe on one side the energy radiation field comes quantized in energy units H by omega with these H by omega energy units, they have to obey, they have to match the energy differences that are available in the molecule. Otherwise, the molecule cannot absorb the light. And then we have here the physical characteristic that makes a process beside that energy has to be conserved, that makes the absorption strong or weak. And that is a property that we call the transition dipole moment of the molecule times the polarization of the radiation field. And so something very practical and important that we learn. Then of course later we see how nature designed these molecules to make this quantity as big as possible. Okay, thank you very much. And let me take a picture again.